Hello, everyone. My name is Braden Webb, and I am a member of First Tech Challenge Team 6547, the Cobalt Colts from Overland Park, Kansas. And today I'd like to provide an overview of the engineering documentation, some of the changes for this year involving the engineering notebook and the new engineering portfolio. And I'll do a few demos in terms of page formatting and gathering information and things like that that are essential to making a good engineering notebook. So first things, here's a little information about my team, the Cobalt Colts. In 2019, the Rover Recca season, we were Inspire Award finalists and a member second pick of the winning alliance at the World Championship in Houston. And last year in 2020, Skystone, we were Inspire Award second place recipients at the Missouri State Championship. And we're also winners of the Design and Compass Award and third place for Promote. And on the screen, you can see some of our contact info, our website, our team email, and our social media. So here's a little overview of our engineering notebook and how it has progressed from back in First Rescue in 2015 through 2020. So you can see that we've developed kind of our computer graphic skills and have used that to improve our engineering notebook, as well as increasing the number of sections that we include in our notebook, making our documentation a little bit more thorough, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how that process works today. So here's an overview of what our presentation is going to contain. First, I'll provide an overview of what the engineering notebook is and explain the major changes for this season ultimate goal. I'll go over the new engineering portfolio, which is the main change for this year, and I'll go over kind of the requirements and suggestions for that. And then I'll discuss the three tiers of the engineering notebook that our team has kind of come up with. And then I will do a few demos about how to gather information and which kind of document editing platform is the best for your team. All right, so first things first, what is the engineering notebook? How do we define what an engineering notebook is? Basically, the engineering notebook is a summary of the entire team's journey throughout the season that can contain things like the robot design process, programming, community outreach efforts, fundraising, budgeting. It should contain everything that your team does throughout the season. It should contain a concise summary, and it should be organized well. So on the screen now, you can kind of see some of the different components that go into that and some of the most important categories that should be included within your engineering notebook. All right, so here are a few of the requirements and suggestions directly from FIRST regarding what the engineering notebook should and should not contain. Firstly, you get a choice between making a handwritten or electronic notebook. This year, due to COVID, electronic is preferred for remote competitions since you'll be sending it in digitally in a PDF or other file type. And if you choose to do a handwritten notebook, it'll be a little bit more difficult because you'll have to scan that into an electronic format. If at some point we do have the opportunity to have in-person competitions, it's likely that you'll need to print your engineering notebook if it's electronic. And please note that if that's the case, you have a limit of a maximum of 2 binders, each containing 3 inches worth of content. One really big rule is that the team number must appear on the front cover of your engineering notebook. The judges will not review your engineering notebook unless it has that information. And we recommend including your team number at the top of every page, like it is at the top of this slide, so that the judges can always remember what team they're looking at. A one-page summary highlighting page numbers for judges to review is very highly recommended. So it's easy for judges to identify the best pages in your notebook since they have limited time to look through it. I believe this is a requirement to have team member biographies, so a little bit of detail about each team member and their contributions to the team. You should have at least one entry from every team meeting, so that can be as simple as a picture or a simple log of what every person did, attendance, things like that. And then for some awards, you also need a business plan, a budget, or a sustainability plan included in your notebook as well. So here are some of the big changes for Ultimate Goal. Obviously, we're used to having engineering notebooks be physical copies that we give to the judges during a presentation that they get to page through in person. But obviously, with the remote situation we're dealing with right now, that's a little bit more difficult. So they've actually made the engineering notebook an optional thing this season, but for a lot of awards, it's necessary to have as a backup that judges can then ask you if you have an engineering notebook. They can ask you to review the full engineering notebook. However, for competition, you will be required to submit what's called the engineering portfolio, which is a 15-page document that I'll go into more detail on the next slide. That is just basically the shortest, most concise, most important information from your engineering notebook that you want the judges to see, and it should be catered towards the specific award criteria, which I'll go over in just a minute. And then obviously it will be submitted in PDF/digital form to the judges rather than them receiving a physical copy since we're currently remote. So here are the requirements for the engineering portfolio, which is the only required evidence of documentation for this season. However, like I mentioned, we recommend that you do keep a full engineering notebook on hand and keep that going throughout the season because judges may ask for more information from you, and that's a nice thing to have. You must submit an engineering portfolio to be eligible for awards. Without one, you will not be eligible to receive any awards at competition. It can be a maximum of 15 pages. However, this does not include the submission for a control award. That's a separate submission. And it's kind of analogous to a team resume. It should contain only the most important information about your team, the most important projects, just very concise but important information, and should be tailored towards each award category, which I'll go through on the next slides. Must contain the team member on the cover, and it's recommended to have at the top of every page. So same thing applies with the engineering notebook and the engineering portfolio. It's a requirement that you list your team number and preferably your team name as well on the front. And we personally, our team recommends having it at the top of each page. And some things that your portfolio could include, summary of the engineering content and the design process of your robot, summary of the team of your team information, so your team members, their contributions to the team, as well as a summary of your community outreach efforts and activities. And finally, a summary of your team plan, business plan, strategy, sustainability plan, something like that. All right, so now I'm going to go over the criteria for each of the judged awards and talk about how you can tailor your engineering portfolio content towards those awards. The biggest piece of advice I can give you is to prioritize. Think about what's the most important projects or design decisions you've made throughout the season, and how can you communicate that in a concise and organized way. And how can you kind of allow the judges to see how you fit into the different award categories really easily. So first things first, we have the Inspire Award, which is arguably the biggest award in FIRST. It's defined as a team that is a strong contender for several other judged awards. It celebrates the strongest qualities of all the judged awards. So a couple of portfolio suggestions for the Inspire Award are to include a summary of your team information, a summary of the design process of your robot, a business or sustainability plan, and it should be high quality, thoughtful, thorough, concise, and well organized. And you should have a complete engineering notebook available for additional review if necessary. Next, we have the Think Award, which is defined as removing engineering obstacles through creative thinking. And the Think Award kind of used to be the award that is heavily based on the engineering notebook, the process with which you document your robot design process was kind of the biggest element towards the Think Award. So obviously creating an engineering portfolio that tailors to that is really important. So a couple of suggestions for the Think Award include detailing a concise summary of the robot design process, including like the most important decisions you've made, prototypes, failures, and successes. You should show physics and math calculations that support the decisions you've made in terms of your design and how it's been optimized to complete the challenge as effectively as possible. And then like every other award, it should be well organized, concise, and thoughtful. And you should include an engineering notebook available for additional review if necessary. Those two things apply to any of the awards. Next, we have the Connect Award, which is given to the team that best connects the dots between community FIRST and the diversity of the engineering world. A couple suggestions for the portfolio are including a team plan that details team building, community outreach, and mentor/student recruitment. That's a big part of the Connect Award is how did you get people interested in FIRST? How did you bring them to your team? How did you start new teams? How did you do things like that to spread FIRST and STEM to new communities? Also examples of time when your team received help from the community. So not only when you offered help to others or you spread FIRST and STEM to others, but also when you reached out to the community for help. For example, if you reached out to a company for fabrication help or things like that, that's a great thing to include for the Connect Award. Kind of shows the two-way communication between your team and the community. Should have a sustainability or a budget or a business plan also. Next, we have the Collins Aerospace Innovate Award, which is defined as bringing great ideas from concept to reality. So you should include a detailed summary of the design process. A huge part is like the sketches and mathematical models and CAD diagrams that you come up with. So like kind of what you visualized initially and how you got from your initial designs through the prototype phase and into your final design. Should include detailed information about the team's journey from the prototypes and the initial sketches and initial ideas to the final design and what decisions were made in terms of what path you took. And it should obviously be organized. And yeah. Next, we have the Control Award, which is simply defined as mastering robot intelligence. So this award has a separate submission, which basically you can highlight some of the really interesting programming and control and sensor decisions and elements that you have as part of your robot. But in terms of the portfolio, obviously that control award submission is not part of the portfolio. So you need to kind of include detailed insight into the programming techniques and algorithms that you used, information about the sensors you used and how they increase the overall intelligence of your robot. And then obviously you must also submit the control award submission form that is not included within the portfolio. Now we have the Motivate Award, which is defined as sparking others to embrace the culture of FIRST. For the portfolio, we recommend including an organization plan, detailing fundraising and budgeting efforts, timelines and finances, community outreach service goals and accomplishments, a demonstration of how your team members are ambassadors of FIRST, and the individual contributions of each team member and how these contribute to the overall success of your team. Now we have the Design Award, which is very similar to the Innovate Award, defined as industrial design at its best. So it should also include details about your CAD and your CAD drawings, your sketches, your pictures of prototypes, and how you've kind of gotten from your initial design to your final design, but should also kind of advocate for why your notebook, or why your robot rather, is unique compared to other robots. What processes in terms of fabrication you used, what design decisions you made that make your robot unique and make it stand out from the rest of the robots you're competing against. Now I'm going to discuss the three tiers of documentation. So these kind of correspond to the different levels of documentation in terms of like if you're a rookie team, more experienced team, kind of where you should fall in terms of how thorough your documentation could be. So the three levels are chronological, summative, and professional. Firstly, we have chronological. This is the best approach for rookie teams who are kind of new to this process. It includes keeping your notebook completely 100% chronological, meaning you have one entry every meeting, and that's all organized. The first page of your notebook is the first meeting, and the last page of your notebook is the last meeting of your season. And at every meeting, you should include a log of who was there, the date, the time, and location of your meeting. It should include information about what each person accomplished. It should include drawings, sketches, photos, CAD screenshots, programming, anything that is useful to show what you did. And it should also include problems and solutions, as well as what you plan to work on in the future. And like I said, it's the simplest approach for rookie teams. So as you can see here, this is a screenshot of some of the pages from our notebook from 2 years ago that just shows this particular meeting was from November 13th of 2018. It shows the attendance who was present at the meeting. It shows pictures of what we got done. And then we actually break it up into build, programming, and public relations. So the build team shows what they got done, their initial goals, what they accomplished. the problems and how they solve those problems, and then goals for the future. Next, we have summative, which is kind of a one level up from chronological. So you should still include chronological documentation. So you should still have kind of what we call daily logs, which is basically information like what I had on the last slide about what each person at each meeting did and accomplished. But also you should include some summary sections that are easier for the judges to just pinpoint, okay, I wanna look at a team's robot design process. Can you give me a section that shows how your you basically went through your season and progressed your robot? So these are what we call summary sections. So they should provide a concise, centralized, and organized storyline of each major step in your process of robot design process, of your CAD, of your programming, of your outreach, things like that. And this could be like monthly updates or updates prior to every competition. So you could show, okay, during the month of October, this is what we got done specifically in terms of our robot design. And then also in a separate section, what we got done in terms of the CAD in the month of October and what we got done in our community, in terms of our community outreach and things like that. You should have a devoted section for robot, CAD, programming, outreach that you just basically tab and tell the judges, okay, if you want to know about our outreach, you should go to this page or this section, and they can flip through and quickly see how you've progressed through the season within one kind of category. And that's really useful because it's not too much more difficult if you have a thorough documentation of your daily progress. It's kind of easy to create these summary sections that basically would necessarily take the same information that's in your chronological documentation, and it would organize them in a concise way for the judges to see specifically one element of your team and how that's progressed. And it's a great documentation strategy for teams who use Agile or other systems for project management that kind of break up your season into smaller chunks. And kind of it's a natural way of organizing it for a team who kind of progresses in smaller chunks than rather than just having a whole season where you just kind of go day by day. So that's summative documentation. And as you can see here, this is an example from one of our pages from last year. So we have detail from updates of our robot. So this is one specific component of our robot, the parallel scissor lifts. So this is information about at that time, how complex it was, how reliable it was, how functional it was, information about how it differed from previous iterations, what we plan to change in the future. And then this is also from a different section. This was our CAD section that shows kind of how our CAD models, how well developed they were at that point in time, how they resembled the real life. Examples in this case was our stone grabber from last year. And then tier three, you have professional. And this is basically just one more layer on top of your chronological and summative documentation. It doesn't add any more pages to your notebook. All it does is it takes the information and allows you, basically is a way of presenting it more visually pleasing. So using more advanced software like Adobe InDesign, which I'll show a little bit later, to create more eye-catching graphics. So as you can see here, this cool kind of triangle graphic was an interesting way to portray what we were saying with our robot and how our CAD models basically were very like real life. And then over here, we have like some visual statistics of our matches and how we compared based on how we predicted we would compare in our compete in our competitions. And then you should also emphasize your branding, a consistent color scheme, consistent fonts and font sizes. And this should obviously all be consistent. Should include things like graphs, data tables, well presented math. So rather than just slapping a picture of your math into the notebook, maybe actually take the time and type it out to show it more so it's easier to follow along. And then you should create your templates so that every page kind of follows a similar trend. And overall that kind of helps to an additional level, like the summative documentation made it easier for the judges to pick out a specific section of your notebook and of your team to look at. This kind of level of professional enhancement allows you to basically present your information in an easier way. So now we're going to get into some of the specific information about how to go about formatting and making your engineering notebook. So the most important part and most difficult component to making an engineering notebook is gathering effective information from your team members. So one system we really strongly recommend you set up is a Google Form or other similar survey where you can collect daily progress from each team member at your meetings. And your engineering notebook editor or editors can easily pull from this information to form the final notebook. The most important part is making sure that your team members contribute quality information, and that's often a hurdle that's difficult to overcome. Using a Google Form actually makes this a lot easier because Google Forms allow you to get a lot of information without asking so many questions. So in a minute, I'll demo how to set up a Google Form and kind of what questions you should ask. Good questions to ask your teammates are, like, obviously their name and date, so you know basically who they are, who filled out the form, and what meeting they're talking about, like what they got done on which date. So what were their initial goals? So this kind of goes back to this slide. Basically, you're gathering information that you can then plug into this format. So asking what were their initial goals for the meeting? What did they end up accomplishing at the meeting? What were their problems? How did they solve them? And goals for the future. And then you should also give them a chance to upload photos or other supplementary pieces of information that you can then include. So basically, by them filling out this form, it allows you to take their answers and plug them into the kind of this format. And it's a very effective way of documenting your progress based upon just this Google form. And it's, you should also develop a system for collecting and organizing photos. So that can be through the Google form, or if you have like a team group chat or something like that, where they can post photos or email them to you or something like that. So obviously your engineering notebook editors should set this up and should basically mandate that after every meeting, everyone who's present at the meeting needs to fill out this form, because it's a huge contributing factor to the engineering notebook. So now I'm going to do a quick demo on how to set up a Google form and how to send that out to your teammates so that they can fill it out. All right, so here we are in my Google Drive. So to create a Google form, you just go over to the new button and go down to Google Form. If you're using a shared folder, it will come up with this. Just hit create and share. And then you can give this a name. So I will call this FTC6547 daily log form. All right. So the first question you're probably going to want to ask is, what is your name? And then what I like to do is use a drop down, and then you can put in different names. Let's say, I don't know. You can put in the names of each of your team members, and then they can select, obviously, who they are. The next question probably is, what is the date? And then you can use the date feature so they can enter a month, day, and a year. Next would be, what were your initial goals for the meeting? This is probably best to be a paragraph or a short answer question so that they can explain in detail what they were hoping to accomplish. And then next would be, what did you end up accomplishing? What did you end up accomplishing at this meeting? Once again, another paragraph answer. Then, what problems did you face? And how did you solve them? Paragraph. And then finally, what do you hope to accomplish next time? And then if you want to go to this route, you can also use file upload, and you can let respondents upload files to your drive. Hit continue. And then allow for specific file types. So the question might be, please upload any photos you took tonight or at today's meeting. You can allow different file types. Really depends on what you're looking for. And then you can change maximum files. I like changing it to the highest just so they have the option if they took a lot of photos to upload that. And then this doesn't really matter. If you're short on space or something, then you can change this, but I'll keep it at 1 gigabyte. Move it down a little bit. There we go, 100. And then you can go up to customize theme. And if you want to make it more kind of your team theme, you can obviously go into, I have a pre-made thing here, image files, there we go. You can upload your own custom header for your form. Doesn't matter that much, but having a purple form for a team that is blue just, you know, might not be as great. So you can change a bunch of the different settings, the fonts, things like that. But obviously that's pretty easy to figure out. And then you can go into settings here, and I'm using a district account, so I need to uncheck this box. You may or may not have that problem. I would recommend saying that they can edit after they submit, and if you want to allow them to see the responses that others have had, you can check this box. That's about all the settings you need to change. And then you can go up here to send, and go over to this link, shorten URL, always better. Copy that, and then say this is like your group chat or something, you just paste the form in, hit enter, and it will send it out to your teammates, and they should be able to fill out your Google form. All right, so now we're going to take a look at probably the most important decision you have to make in terms of your engineering notebook, and that is what kind of platform you use, what document editor you use to make your notebook. So the three that I will discuss today are Google Drive, Microsoft Office, and Adobe. And there are pros and cons to each of those. Starting with Google Drive, it's probably the easiest for new teams and teams who want everyone to be able to contribute to the engineering notebook because it's extremely easy to share files and everyone can edit files at the same time. It uses obviously Google Drive, Google Docs, Google Sheets, and those programs. It's easy to use. It doesn't have a lot of features, however, so it's a little hard to, you know, if you want to go a little crazy with the graphics and things like that, it's not the best program for that, but it is free. So, and probably most people already have an account if you have a school account or something like that. And then we have Microsoft Office, which is a little less easy to collaborate with. It uses OneDrive instead of Google Drive, obviously. I'm not as familiar with it. I know that you can share files with people. I don't know if you can actually work on files simultaneously. I would assume that you could. It has more features than Google Docs does, which makes it a little better. It's easier, a little more. It's not as easy to use, but it has more features. And in most cases, it is free. And then we have Adobe, which is the kind of the outlier here. It is not free. However, you might be able to get a student discount depending on your school district and things like that. It is very heavy on features. It has, obviously, Adobe comes with Photoshop, Illustrator, InDesign. InDesign is the main document editor. Photoshop allows you to edit photos and things like that, and Illustrator allows you to create graphics. There's a little bit of a learning curve to it. It's not quite as easy to use as like Google Drive or Microsoft Office, and it's very difficult to collaborate with. So if you kind of have one person that does a lot of your notebook stuff in terms of like actually formatting the pages and creating the finished product, that might be a good path to go down. So only one person has to get the software, and then you can use like Google Forms or Google Docs to kind of collaborate in terms of gathering your content and then put it into Adobe for your final product. And it uses a cloud called Creative Cloud to store all your files. So now I'm going to do a quick demo of how to format a page in Google Drive. And then following that, I will format the same page in Adobe InDesign to show you kind of how the two softwares are different and things like that. So. All right, so here we are back in Google Docs, and I'm going to show you now how to format this page in Google Docs. So I'm going to go back to my Google Drive, and I'm going to go to this new button and hit New Google Doc, Create and Share. Give it some title. Let's call it Doc 1, obviously. Call it something a little bit better than that. First things first, I'm going to show you how to create this header, which will basically automatically propagate to every page that you create. So it'll be kind of universal, so every page will automatically have the same header. What you do is you double click the top of the page to open up this header. And then what I do is I do insert image, upload from computer. I have these images already open here. Got the Ultimate Goal logo, and what I do is I click this third break text button. I'm gonna make it smaller, and doing break text allows me to move it freely. I'm gonna get rid of the Qualcomm logo in this case. And then, there we go. And then I'm gonna do the same, insert image, upload from computer. I'm gonna do the FTC logo. Once again, break text, make it small, and then move it over. And then finally, I'm going to insert image, upload from computer, and we're gonna do the Cobalt Colts logo. I'm going to make it smaller once again. Get a lot smaller actually, and then double click to crop it. Get rid of that, and then I'm going to place this in the middle of the page. So that, if I do Control Enter, that creates a new page. As you can see, it will keep the same formatting all the way down. And then let's say we want to do a page number at the bottom. So I'm going to go down here, I'm going to double click at the bottom. And I'm going to go into Insert, Page Numbers, and I'm going to click this one in the bottom left here. And I like my page numbers on the right side of the page, so I'm going to right justify that. And then I'm going to add, say this is section A, I'm just going to add an A dash to the beginning of it. I'm going to highlight it, and I'm going to change it to Times New Roman. Obviously, you can change it to what you want. And double click to exit. And as you can see, this page is A1, this page becomes A2, and if I wanted, we can make A3. Now, if you want to create a simple daily log, you can do is say you want title, want that to be in this font, and I will do daily log, and today is 10-18-20, and then I will make this normal text, Times New Roman 12. And attendance, great, I'm the only one here right now. So, and the date, actually I already put the date, location, Cobalt Colts headquarters, where our meetings take place. And then obviously we need a time of the meeting. So time would be, our normal meeting time is 7 o'clock to 9 o'clock. And then, obviously, if you want to insert a horizontal line to break up the page, you can do insert horizontal line. And now you can start, obviously, typing everything like normal, adding bullet points. And if you want to insert an image, I'll just insert the logo, again. Obviously, you would insert images that supplement what you're talking about. And if you do this feature, if you do the second option, it will automatically wrap the text around your image. So that's basically how to format a page in Google Docs. Now I'm going to show you how to format a similar page in Adobe InDesign. All right, so here we are in Adobe InDesign. Here's obviously you can see the recent files I've been working on. If we want to create a new document, we can hit Create New. We can give it a title. And I'm going to change the units in inches. I'm going to make this an 8.5 by 11 inch page with margins half an inch. That's fine. One page to start with. And then I'm going to hit create. It's going to give me a page that looks like this. So we're going to first create what's called a master page. And a master page in InDesign is basically a template that you can then apply to new pages and actually edit. So what we're going to do is we're going to go to this A master that's already been created for us. And I'm going to double click this hand to center the page. And now we're going to create that same header that we used in, that we had in Google Docs. So I'm going to actually create it on this page. So I'm going to go up to File, Place. And if I go in and I find, the wrong place. Sorry about that. Here we go. I will insert the Ultimate Goal logo and it allows me, it connects to my cursor and then I go up to the corner and I click and drag and then I can resize that. Can move that over just like so. And it creates an Ultimate Goal logo here. Now I'm going to do the same. Keyboard shortcut for file place is Control D. Place the FTC logo in. I'm going to do the same. Click and drag, and it will have a transparent background. And I'm going to make it a little smaller. Oh, not perfect. Obviously, probably take more time to make sure it's nice and formatted. And then one more way you can insert an image is to use the CC libraries. So if you've saved images or files to your Creative Cloud library, which is the drive or the cloud system that Adobe uses, you can click CC libraries. It'll take a minute to load and then you can navigate to, I'll do logos and graphics in this case, and I will find our full blue logo. We'll click and drag and then, whoops, it will drag that like that and then double click and readjust its position. Might be a little big, but it'll work for now. And then say you want to say you don't want to put anything else on the page above this kind of line here. If you go up to the top to this ruler and click and drag down, that'll create a little guide. So you just create a note, nothing goes above this line. All right. So let's say you want to create a page number. Click on the text, create a text box, and you can go into type, insert special character, markers, current page number. So this is, says A because it's called master page A. I'll show you when we apply this master page to an actual page, that will change to page one. So if I want to make A1, I would do A-A for now. I can go up, I can make the size bigger if I want to. I can change the font, do Times New Roman. And then you can move this text box around. Say I want to put this in the center. I do Control B to open this window, center it vertically, and then I can center it horizontally. Then finally, I can drag another one of these guides down to say nothing goes below that mark on the page. All right. Then finally, we'll create the actual kind of text that we want here. Let's say I go to my default font here. And I'll make it a bit bigger and I can say daily log 10-18-20. And then change it back to Times New Roman 12, and I can say attendance. time, 7 o'clock p.m. to 9 o'clock p.m. And then location, Cobalt Colts headquarters. Say I don't like the way that's spaced out, I can go into paragraph and I can change, I believe it's this feature, to change the spacing, make it a little bit better. This looks bold, might not be, it is bold. We'll change that to regular. And then if you want to add a line underneath it, you can grab the line tool, press. If you hit shift, it will stay horizontal, drag it over. And then you can change the thickness of your line. Hit save, save your document. I'm not going to save it now, but you would save it. And then finally, to put in your actual text, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make this top text box smaller, and then I'm going to make a bigger text box. It goes all the way down here. And what I'm going to do is I want more margins on my box, so I'm going to do Control B. I'm going to change the spacing to, let's say, a quarter inch, and that pop it inward. So I could say Roman once again, tasks accomplished. And then I can go to paragraph and I can hit bullets. The coolest feature specifically for this demo is the fact that I can go up to type. And I can hit fill with placeholder text. And I can fill the page with text, obviously, just to show you what it looks like. Obviously, you would want to fill it with meaningful text. And then say you want to insert an image, I will go over to CC Libraries, and I'll actually pick a real photo this time. I will go down to, say, pick this photo here. Click on it, I'll drag it out. It will not automatically text wrap, but I can change that. I go up here to these four buttons here, I'll wrap around bounding box, and it will automatically text wrap. I can increase the frame size and the frame color. If I want a blue frame, I can do that. And now I can preview. So this is a master page. And say I want to create an actual daily log entry. What I can do is I'm going to delete this page for now. Actually, I'll create a new page. Create a new real page, sorry. And then I will delete this page. Okay, and then say I want to apply the template I have in A master to this blank page, which is actually part of the document. I click on it, I right click, I do apply master to pages, I drop down, I click A master, I click OK. And now we see our page that we made show up here. So to say this is a template and I want to make some edits to it. So you can see I can't currently click on any of the pieces of the page, it's all locked. If I hold Control and Shift and I click on something, it allows me to edit it. It breaks it from the template and allows me to edit. So if I do Control Shift and I highlight everything here, it allows me to change everything. I would not recommend highlighting this stuff though, because you probably want that to stay the same. As you can see, we're now on page one. So this became A-1. And now you can go through, make changes to everything. So that's the basics of how to format a page in Adobe InDesign. All right, so now that we've seen how to format pages in both Google Docs and Adobe InDesign, I hope you've taken some tips from that to think about how you want to format your pages and what software you want to use for your engineering notebook and engineering portfolios this year. I hope this information was helpful. If you have any more questions for me or for my teammates, our contact info is on the slide here. You can visit our website at ftc6547.org. You can email us at ftc6547@gmail.com, or you can contact us on social media. All of our Facebook Twitter, Instagram. Our handles are at FTC6547. With that said, thank you very much for watching. Like I said, if you have any more questions, reach out to us. This is Braden from the Cobalt Colts. Thank you very much.